CBS Sports proudly presents the American Lamar Series. After a three-month break, the chase for the series championship begins in earnest today. In fact, it starts a stretch of four races over the next 5 weeks. It's shaping up to be a blockbuster summer in American road racing.
The American Le Mans Series. Cool cars, world-class drivers, premier road courses. Born in France in 1923 with the first running of the 24 Hours of Le Mans, the ALMS is the glamour, the glory, and the grueling reality of sports car racing. European style with American attitude. Drivers from around the world strut their speed, skill, and endurance. Four separate classes racing on the track at the same time. It is the chain that connects the new and the faithful sports car fans of an extraordinary endurance racing tradition. This is the American Le Mans Series.
Welcome to the Mid-Ohio Sports Car Course for CBS Sports coverage of round two of the American Le Mans Series, America's premier sports car racing championship. These teams have already had a 12-hour race in March, and many of them are fresh from the world's greatest endurance race, the 24 Hours of Le Mans. In fact, three of the four class winners at Le Mans are in action here today. And while this race is a shorter sprint, only 2 hours and 45 minutes in length, just like Le Mans, we'll have four different types of cars on the track, all racing for the win in their individual classes. The fastest of those are two sets of prototypes called P1 and P2. You'll find them at the front of our starting grid.
My name's James Weaver. I'm driving Rob Dyson's number 16 Loader MG with Butch Leitzinger.
Hi, I'm Ted Zeletto, driving for car number 38, ADT champion Audi with Marco Verde.
I'm Andy Wallace, driving Dyson Racing car number 20 with Chris Dyson.
I'm Brian Willman. I drive the number 56 team Bucknum Racing Pilbeam with Chris McMurray and Jeff Bucknum.
In P1 qualifying yesterday, we had a sensational battle for the pole position, ultimately won by James Weaver in the Dyson Lola. Now, he smashed the track record by 2 seconds. Following his run, we listened into the team's radio communication.
Good job, James.
I need to do another lap or not. Keep an eye on late, though. I can't go quicker because I'm in a bit of a pig in the air of the last corner, mate.
Okay. Well, James did not need to go faster. He had pit Marco Werner in the champion Audi by a mere 600ths of a second. And in fact, there are two of these Dyson Lolas in the field today. It should be a fascinating battle. But in P2, it was Jeff Bucknum in the Pilbeam. He was sensational also. In fact, the team always runs well here at Mid-Ohio. The team won here 2 years ago. The big question mark is the engine. Can it last 2 hours and 45 minutes? But now let's take a look at our production-based classes, starting with the GTS runners.
I'm Oliver Gavin. I drive the number 4 CompuWare Chevrolet Corvette. And my teammate is Olivier Beretta.
I am Johnny O'Connell, driving with Ron Fellows, both of us in the number 3 CompuWare Chevrolet Corvette.
Hi, I'm Johnny Molam. I'm driving the Asemco Saline S7R, and my teammate is Terry Bolchula.
Hi, I'm Clint Field from Dublin, Ohio, driving the number 30 Marquee Financial Lola B2K40 Judd. I'll be driving with Robin Liddell this weekend.
My name's James Gouet. I'm from Athens, Georgia. I'm driving the number 10 Miracle Motorsports P2 entry. My co-drivers are Ian James and John Macaluso.
With the Ferraris not here this week, we will most likely see the two Corvettes battling each other out for the GTS class win today. But keeping them on their toes will be the Asemco Saline that finished in qualifying third and had the fastest lap this morning. You're also going to see a brand new Lamborghini Murciélago fresh out of the box that will be making its ALMS debut today. A tough day for Carsport, though. Their Dodge Viper is out. They blew a motor earlier this morning, their second one in 2 days. They are headed home to prep for Lime Rock next week. Now let's meet the team that will lead the GT field.
Hi, I'm Jörg Bergmeister. I'm driving number 23 McKenna, Mitchell Webb, Alex Schopp, Racing Porsche, together with Timo Bernhard.
The GT class, Alex Job Racing, has been the team to beat over the last couple of years. Two team championships, three drivers' championships to their credit. Timo Bernhard has put his number 23 McKenna Porsche on the pole once again here this weekend. But oddly enough, what Alex Job has never done is win at Mid-Ohio. It'll be interesting to see if they can do that here this weekend. But if they are going to win here this weekend, they will have to beat a rejuvenated Panos program. The Panos Esperante GT LM came here qualified second with only three qualifying laps, and that's because they've blown not one but two engines during practice and qualifying. They've gone to a third engine. It'll be interesting to see if they have the longevity to battle with the Porsches. But don't forget, too, the Ferrari 360 Modena of Risi Competizione GT should be a barn burner. Ralph?
All right, Brian, thanks. Hi, everybody. Ralph Shaheen, along with a colleague of ours who's had many laps around this racetrack in his sports car, Bill Adam. As you see, the cars are out on the racetrack getting set for the green. Now, Bill, this track, very demanding, and they've made some changes to it in the winter.
It is a beautiful track, very, very demanding, very challenging, and one of the biggest changes is going to have a huge effect on tires today. Normally, Michelin runners can double stint it. They can run it twice as long. But over this rough concrete patch, they're finding very unusual wear characteristics. I think everybody will be forced to change tires every single pit stop today.
The other thing that comes into play here, because it is so tight, demanding the traffic.
Traffic certainly is very tough here at this track because there really is only one long straight, and there are a number of corners that are linked together. It means that if you don't get past at the start of one corner, you may be stuck behind a slow car for two or three corners. That itself will, I think, force some of the drivers into highly risky passes that they normally wouldn't do at other tracks.
You see the rest of the starting grid in our eye box on the upper left of your screen. Now, here's a look at our Michelin field summary as we get set for the start.
Michelin tires once again outnumbering anybody else on this field, but Pirelli have made a very strong comeback here. They've come with a number of new compounds, and in fact, every single team that we spoke with that is running Pirellis were very happy with not only the traction they're giving, but also the wear characters. Goodyear, well, they've got bragging rights right now because they're on the pole with the Dyson car.
And this race does start on the back straightaway here at Mid-Ohio. Getting ready to come up to speed. There's a green and we're underway.
Wow, and that should not have been a green. The champion car was out in front of the pole sitter. I wonder immediately, could this possibly be a penalty? You see both Corvettes slashing by Willman and he's slowing.
Yep, the P2 car off. There he is through the grass. And the 16 Dyson car is off too.
Oh, jeez.
Maybe it didn't jump the start, Bill.
I think you're exactly right. They must have pulled off prior to the start, which then makes it perfectly legal for the champion ADT Audi. Here we are, we're on Borden right now. This is Marco Werner, the phenomenal driver from Germany in this car who has just been blistering. Came to this series last year, had never driven on any American tracks. And talk about a fast learner. Oh, gee.
He cannot believe, I'm sure, the luck that has fallen his way at the start to see one of the two cars that he figured was really going to give him a run for the money out of it already before they even take the green.
Well, we just checked in with the Dyson Racing Group. They believe that Butcher's engine just shut down. They're trying to get him back in the car so they communicate with him and see what the problem is. So that was not the start they were looking for. Very confident going in. And the news on the Pillbeam boys as well, it may be the engine is gone already. There were concerns with that bigger 3.4-liter Willman engine. It didn't even make it a lap, Ralph.
Well, I'll take it, Calvin, but one of the problems here is that unlike Le Mans, where if something goes wrong, you've got 23 hours and 59 minutes to make it up. Here, with it being a sprint race, you're effectively out of it. And even if James Weaver can get going, it would have to take a tragedy to befall the leaders in order that James could catch up. Right now, Andy Wallace is working very hard trying to keep some pressure on that champion car.
Let's see what happened to the 16 and Butch Leitzinger at the start.
Oh! You see him pull off at the top of the straight, too. That is probably half a mile before the green flag is even up there. So Butch knew very early on he had a major problem.
Pick the action back up with the champion Audi out front, the number 38, the R8, as it's known in Audi's lineage, and an amazing car.
Indeed, I've said before that this will probably go down in history as the greatest sports racing car of all time because it seems to work well on these tracks, on ultra-high-speed tracks, on street circuits. It just is a very well-designed car, and then the people that work on it, the crews love it because of the ease of the maintenance in this car.
And that's one of the things that actually has given it such great credit is definitely how easy it is to work on it. That is one of the things that's made it so famous.
Yes.
Back deeper in the pack now, the GTS, the top line for the production cars. There's the two Corvettes out in front. And it's Oliver Gavin leading Ron Fellows, number four Corvette, in front of the number three. And right behind them, Terry Bortscheller in the Saline.
This is the battle of cubic inches right now because both of these Corvettes are 7 liters. The Saline that is following is also a 7 liter. So Chevrolet right now is winning this battle, but only by a couple of seconds. And Bortscheller, unlike the Corvettes, which are both on Goodyear tires, that Saline is on Pirelli tires. I'm sorry, the Corvettes last year were on Goodyear tires. The Goodyears are now gone from Corvettes. They're on Michelin's.
That's right. Michelin's the tire of choice now for the Corvette team. And talking to them about that, I asked Ron Fellows, he said, this is the first time you've been here to Mid-Ohio with the Michelins. How did it affect the car? And he went, oh, yeah, that's right. He completely forgot. It's been a very easy adjustment for them to the new Michelin tires. The Saline seems to be hanging in there, Bill, not losing contact with them yet.
No, Bortscheller really is staying very close. And as it was pointed out earlier, this is the car, the Asenco Saline, that did run the quickest lap in the warm-up this morning. So the car does have a lot of potential. It's a great-looking car as well.
Now let's make our way back through the field behind the Saline. And Terry Bortscheller is actually the first of the P2 field.
And moviegoers might look at that car and say, wasn't that God's car? And yes, it was.
Clint Field is actually leading that. And there's the one we've all been waiting to see if you're a fan of the American Le Mans Series, a Lamborghini Murcielago. There's actually two of them here this weekend. This is the number five. And Cox is leading right. Peter Cox driving that car right now. And they're running solidly in fourth.
It's very nice to see this car make an appearance. Ultra exotic. I think it's on everybody's dream list. And every time the car has come on the track from the very first session, it's been very reliable and just gets quicker and quicker. David Braben, Peter Cox, very pleased with the development, but this is so early in the program. They came near realizing that they really couldn't expect to challenge the Corvettes at this point. So they're being patient, working with Dick Barber Racing, a famous name through the American Le Mans Series over the years. And this will be a contender eventually, but right now it's just beautiful and sounds spectacular.
So the Lambo running in fourth in GTS right now. An amazing big belch of flame out of the back of the V12. Well, we had an opportunity to talk to some of the drivers about what their favorite movies are and some of their favorite movie lines.
Well, there's one particular line in the movie that I think is brilliant. It's from Jackass the movie. You'll have to figure out for yourselves which part of the movie it is. But there's one bit where the doc says to the guy who's playing the prank, he says, you shouldn't tell your wife about this. You shouldn't tell anybody about this. He turns around to his mate and he says, he knows that's already too many people. I think that's great.
Let me give you that thought. I know Ralph Shaheen's favourite movie is Hot Dog the movie, and mine would have to be Gone with the Wind, and the favourite line is, frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
CBS Sports coverage of American Le Mans at Mid-Ohio is sponsored by Porsche. Porsche, there is no substitute. And by Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
Welcome back to Mid-Ohio. Out front, leading P1 right now, Marco Werner. That's the car at the top of the screen, the white machine, the Audi. Chasing him is Andy Wallace. Still, that's a great battle there. The P2 class is led by Clint Field in the Intersport Racing entry. GTS, Oliver Gavin in the Corvette out in front. And in GT, Timo Bernhard in the Porsche. Let's go to that battle right now. There goes Timo. McKenna back number 23. Now, while we were in commercial, there's quite a bit of action in the GT class. Some great racing's been going on there. Watch out in front. The Painos up to second. David Salins just went in too deep.
He just simply did. He got in far too deep, carrying a little bit too much speed, but really didn't get too rattled. Kind of drove from the edge of the track and just carried right back on again.
And Darren Law in the Flying Lizard Porsche number 45 having a great run as well as he makes the pass there to pick up the position. Darren right now running up in 14th. Overall, he had gotten around Mark Leib. That puts Darren fourth in GT.
And this is the car right here. That's David Salins in that silver and green panels that is trying hard to close up on Timo Bernhardt. Timo has about a 5-second lead right now. He's having a wonderful year so far because he and his co-driver, Jörg Burgmeister, they won Sebring. And of course, Jörg went on to win Le Mans as well. So very strong team, as is almost typical for Alex Job Racing. But this car is catching them by bits and pieces.
Let's check in with Brian Till.
Well, indeed, the fastest GT car on the track right now is the Panos. Young Gunnar Jeanette, part of this rejuvenated Panos team. Gunnar, you guys had problems in both practice and qualifying with a motor. You have the confidence in this one that's going to last the distance?
Yeah, absolutely. The guys at Elan Power Products really make a good engine. And the engine before we used for all the testing to actually get here had about 6,000 kilometers on it with no problems. So it really puzzled us when we got here and we had to do two motor changes. One was a little issue with the manifold that we ended up finding out, and we just wanted to be safe and change it, make sure that we were going to qualify okay. And then the qualifying thing was a bit of a mistake on our part. But the car qualified well. The engine in there is really strong right now, and David's doing an awesome job.
The car has a lot of horsepower in it, which should be strong down the straightaway. But I think what you guys seen too, it does handle through the corners back there, Ralph.
That it does, Brian. And I can tell you one car that's handling real well right now is the Dyson entry for Andy Wallace, because we've got a change for the lead. He's moved in front of Marco Werner, who we're on board with. The Audi now back to second.
Yeah, I was just wondering a second ago if maybe Andy Wallace had got orders from the Dyson camp to start pushing, because it looked like he started getting deeper and deeper under braking. You could see the back of the car wiggling, just maximum effort under braking, and adhesion was just barely hanging on. Now, what we talked earlier of is that traffic is always a problem. You're going to see right here, and I watched the Audi close up because Dyson got blocked a bit. Now, this may give the Audi a chance at the end of the straight. He will.
He's going to try the outside, headed down to the keyhole. Got to get back to the inside, and Andy gets there first and is able to shut the door. Now we're coming out onto one of the longer straightaways here, the backstretch. Let's see if the horsepower of the Audi can take over.
I don't think so. This is one of the good things about the balancing of classes in the ALMS, is that even though the Dyson car is running a much smaller motor, it weighs a lot less. So it accelerates very, very quickly off the corners. And the other end of the straight, down in braking, since you're not slowing down as much weight, it brakes even better than the Audi does.
This is where the Dyson car should be able to stretch out its legs through these tight, twisty sections. We went through the S's. Now we're making our way over to Thunder Valley.
And right here, this corner here, you'll see it kind of drop away a bit. Yesterday at qualifying, Marco Werner, well, boy, oh boy, he is spectacular over the crest of that hill. Getting the Audi all sideways, trying to get all 600 horsepower down to the ground.
Very scary section of racetrack as we're now into the carousel, headed to the front stretch where the pass actually took place. And let's take a look at that. On board with Werner.
And you see he was just blocked a little bit by that Porsche. And watch alongside. You're going to see up the inside.
There he goes.
That's it. That's all it takes, just a momentary loss. The car behind you able to get under the throttle a little bit earlier. Just steps in the gas a fraction earlier. These cars are so equal that that little Lola was able to shoot by the Audi.
And now, boy, they have really started to stretch that out a little bit. And problems have come to the 37 of John Field and Duncan Dayton in the P1 class, Calvin.
Yes, indeed. That's a big disappointment here. The local man, John Field. The attrition rate is high here today. What put the 37 car out, John?
Well, we'd lost third and fourth gear for some reason. Something in the box went haywire. It just wouldn't catch. There's oil all over the back end of the cowling. So car was running great up to that point. It's a tough deal for us. Hope we'll root for Clint right now. They're going to try to get back together and get us out in the race, but a bit disappointing.
As he said, they're going to root for Clint. That's his son. He's currently leading P2, but this is one of the teams that went over to Le Mans, and when they get those cars back, Ralph, it's really a big turnaround to try and get ready for this sprint race. That may have been a cause of the problem today.
Quite possibly, Calvin. Logistically, it's an absolute nightmare.
Yeah, I talked with Brad Kettler, the crew chief for Champion Racing, and he was dead beat tired.
Next Saturday, see championship performances in softball, rowing, men's and women's tennis, men's and women's golf, and outdoor track and field on the NCAA Spring Highlight Show. Stay with us. We'll be right back for more of the American Le Mans Series from Mid-Ohio on CBS right after this. Tonight on CBS begins with America's number one news magazine, 60 Minutes, followed by television's most watched new drama, Cold Case. Then Melissa Gilbert and Ozzie Davis star in The Soul Collector. It's all here tonight on CBS, America's most watched network. There's our race leader and P1 class leader, Andy Wallace, out in front, pulling away and having a great battle with Marco Werner giving chase. We talked, as you can see, those concrete patches. Calvin Fish took a look at the work that's been done to Mid-Ohio.
One of the unique characteristics of the Mid-Ohio racetrack is the fact that you have these concrete patches running through the middle of all of the corners. And during the long off seasons that they have here in the winter period, it created some settling going on in these concrete patches to the effect that it really got very bumpy. Now, during this past off-season, the track has gone to work with a grinding machine and done a very effective job of smoothing out the racing surface. But the consequences have been we've been left with these very narrow grooves running through the racing line. What I've done here is take an impression of the racetrack itself. And as we turn this over and take a closer look, you can see these narrow ridges, and they have almost like a razor edge to them that was really tearing up the tires. In fact, during preseason testing, some of the teams found they could only get 15 to 20 laps out of a set of tires. With a full fuel load today, the number needs to be 40 to 50, so they had to make some adjustments. Certainly the balance of the race car is critical, but the other change they've made has gone to a slightly harder tire compound, which is certainly more durable. And I think the key to victory today is if any of these teams can get a double stint out of that set of tires.
Yeah, and I think one of the problems right now is that that's a compromised situation, that the track had really ground those away in the interest of safety to make the corners better, to make them last longer and stop them from breaking up. But the downside is that they are chewing up these tires, and we've seen problems come up with the Michelin tires that normally, as we said earlier, you can run for double stints, like maybe a couple of straight hours without a problem. Now for safety, they're changing them every hour.
Well, and we've had a change in GT. The 50, number 50 Panos has had a big problem. You can see the damage to the left front of the nose of the Panos. Unfortunately, really gonna hurt that car, slowing them way down right up in the thick of this battle. Started second today, been up front all afternoon long, and now they've got some serious issues with the number 50. Let's head down to pit lane and Brian Till with more from the story of the Panos pits. Brian?
Earlier we had a chance to talk to Gunnar Jeanette about the promise of this new Panos GT ALM car. David Salins, a great job in qualifying, and it looked like the race held so much promise, but what happened on the track?
Well, I tell you, this is something I have never seen in my whole racing career, and I have done some races up till now. That guy was lapped, his car was hanging together with some tape. He was doing, I don't know, 3 minutes a lap. Look, I was just behind him. He locked up all the brakes going into the corner. I thought he was spinning up, and then he, as a matter of fact, catched it back, pointed into the right direction. I was in the middle of the corner. He just ran straight into me. I don't know, but some people should definitely think before they race with real cars, you know?
Well, they're working diligently to get the car back on the track, but obviously very far down through the order this Panos car has fallen. You can hear the disappointment on David Salins' voice and the rest of this Panos team, guys.
What a tough break for that team. That car really showing lots of promise here today.
Yeah, and I think it's important that they do get back in the race, too, because with this being a new car, they really need all of the track development time they can get. And even though they're a long way out of the possibility of winning, they need to run all of these laps as hard as they can to make it a car that they hope to finally beat Porsche with.
Timo Bernhard still leading in the GT class for Alex Job Racing. Let's take a look at what's going on in P2. Winfield out in front. The local boy having a pretty good run here today. Actually, the second car in line, that one right there, the number 30. The class leader in P2. Having a pretty solid afternoon so far. Any major problems for them at all.
Yeah, Clint Field has had a pretty magical year so far. This is one of the teams that did come back from a win at Le Mans. And of course, the win is being credited to Mike Johnson, their crew chief. He wants to take total credit, said the drivers had nothing to do with the victory.
As always is the case. That's a look at second and third in P2. Lally running in second. Third is James right now in the number 10 machine. Ian James out of Orlando, Florida, right there in the miracle car, running back in third. Andy Lally just in front of him in the white and blue car, holding on to second in P2 as both of them try to close in on Clint Field. The gap is rather extensive at this point between first and second.
Yeah, Field actually right now is pulling away by just a tiny bit. For example, last lap, he was about 0.6 seconds faster than Ian James, who in turn is just a little bit quicker than Andy Lally right now. So they're all running very competitive times.
There's your class leader in P2. And when you get on a roll like Clint is right now, boy, it's hard.
It is.
To have any trouble, and he should be on a high roll after how things went at Le Mans. This 21-year-old from nearby Dublin, Ohio, his first ever trip to Le Mans, and he comes home a winner at the famed Sarthe Circuit. Stay with us. We'll be back for more of the American Le Mans Series on CBS. Tuesday, July 6th on CBS, the Emmy-winning Amazing Race is back and better than ever. With new teams pushed to the limit, don't miss it. The new Amazing Race premieres Tuesday, July 6th on CBS, America's most watched network. We're back to Mid-Ohio, and here's a look at the class leaders. And there's your Andy Wallace leading in P1 and followed right behind him. Marco Werner in the Audi still glued to him, as these two have been slicing their way through the field, lapping past the Lamborghini right now. Clint Field also leading in P2, right in the middle of that pack, getting lapped right now as Andy Wallace comes by on the inside of him. Lally and James running second and third, and GTS, well, it's still the two Corvettes out in front, and the Saline running right behind him as Porcelli tries to keep them within sight. And GT, it's Porsche all up front, but Bill, the one thing about Porsche right now, Porsche has spread the technology throughout the field, and they've also spread the drivers throughout the field, giving us a great parity here.
Yeah, it's one of the things that a couple of the teams complained about last year, that there was a favoritism being shown to Alex Job Racing, who was the American arm of the factory team. So this year, Porsche said, fine, you want the pieces, here they are, just come and buy them. And oops, there's the Audi peeling in the pits. Now, that's a shock. We all thought the Lola MG would go in first, but Marco Werner is coming down pit lane.
Much earlier than expected. This is a car that normally can go longer than everybody else.
Usually, now look at Marco inside. There's the crew already. That's JJ up on the wall, so he's expected to get in right away.
Let's head down to pit lane. Calvin Fish.
Well, there will indeed be a driver change here. Marco Werner jumping out. Remember, he's never driven here before. JJ certainly has. In fact, he won here in the GT class back in 2001. Now, one of the unique characteristics of this form of sports car racing is that whilst the refueling is being done, the other mechanics may not work on the car like you see in Grand Prix racing or NASCAR racing. So they have to wait for this refueling to be completed before they can do the wheel change. And that is why if they can double stint these tires, it is so critical because it will save on their overall pit stop here. But we see the guns at the ready. They're only allowed two guns, one on each side, and they're going to be putting a fresh set of Michelins. They actually have a scrub on these tires, but we understand there's a problem with the 20 machine.
Well, we got problems in the GT class, actually, Cal. The 24 Alex Job machine is the one that's beached off in the dirt in the sand trap.
Well, and I'll tell you, this is something that could have an enormous effect in the race, because what Dyson may do right now, the Dyson team, tell Andy to stay out. They are praying for a pace car, and I don't think that they are going to be praying wrong, because if this car can't get out of the sand, they have got to pull it out. That's a dangerous place.
The other car that was involved in that was Ralph Kellner's in the Ferrari 360 on the left, right side of your screen. Let's see what happens here. Andy Wallace just in front of them. Mark Lieb got up the inside.
Oh, man. Oh, no, that's just the wrong thing to try. He tried to get so deep under braking. Kellner's red Ferrari was already getting as close as possible. The Dyson car is in. They're not waiting for a pace car.
Brian Till.
Well, that's right, guys. The 20 car on pit road. Young Chris Dyson will be taking over the wheel from Andy Wallace. A lot of pressure on this young driver's shoulders. This is the race leading car. When they brought this in, the yellow came out at just the wrong time for these guys. Bill, you said if they could stay out on the racetrack, that would be good, but the car was already on pit lane, so they'll have to live with what it is that they've got. Let's get down with Calvin Fish.
Well, the leaders in GTS, the winners from Le Mans, are in the pits. Oliver Gaventon over now to the Frenchman, Olivier Beretta, and we expect these guys to look for tires as well. These have switched from the Goodyear tires last year, or for many years, in fact, over to the Michelin. And sometimes they are looking at a double stint. We've talked about the abrasive nature of this Mid-Ohio racetrack. Even these guys on Michelins cannot double stint tires. So they've got to really a race amongst themselves with the three car running in second, four car pitting slightly early. At this point, the four car is just praying they don't see a yellow flag, which would then give the edge to the sister car. Pit stop is complete. Loretta's on his way.
That's right, Calvin. There is actually no full course yellow right now. There's only a local yellow in the section of where the incident was. Now the pits are closed. They're bringing out the pace car. This turns everything upside down.
Bill. What a huge stroke of luck to the number three Corvette, because now they can make their stop. Once the pits reopen, they can make their stop under a yellow flag situation behind the pace car. They lose a fraction of the time compared to their team car.
And a good break for the 38, because the pit strategy with the yellows coming out didn't really hurt them as bad as it could have.
Not at all. If Dyson had been able to stay out one or maybe two more laps, oh, what a huge advantage that could have been. Then they could have made their stop under yellow conditions, lost hardly any time at all.
There's the Dyson car, and you can only imagine the amount of pressure on Chris Dyson right now, as he knows he's about to battle it out with one of the best veterans in the field, J.J. Leto. Let's see what happened. On board with Mark Lieb.
Yeah, now you're going to be watching up and now there's the Dyson car going by, and he tries to go down the inside. Watch right there. Watch the Ferrari. He's going to be coming over, and suddenly there's the contact. I mean, he was completely in the clear, Kellenders was.
The rule of thumb, as you see Mark Lieb still stuck in the dirt in the sand trap, is you have to be at least halfway up alongside of the guy that you're trying to pass before you clearly have the lane.
Yeah, I mean, even if you get your front fender up alongside their door, they're still not going to be able to see you. You're concentrating so hard on the corner, trying to figure out where your braking is going to be completed, where do you start your turn into the corner. So at that point, no, you're not looking at your door mirrors like you would be, say, in street driving.
And the other problem for Kellenders is the fact that he's thinking, well, I've got to make sure Andy Wallace clears me before I even move over.
Yeah, it's a pretty busy section of track right then.
Now, if you're J.J. Leto.
Kind of interesting. One of the GT Porsches just went blowing by the leader as he's following the pace car.
For year-round sports coverage with late-breaking news and the best fantasy games on the internet, go to CBSSportsLine.com. And AmericanLeMans.com with live timing and scoring.
J.J. Leto right there. Oh, there's the Peterson Motorsport Porsche.
Well, it's been an onboard now with the Peterson White Lightning entry, who also had a great trip to Le Mans.
Their dreams came true over there.
Finding themselves in victory lane. Peterson Le Mans GT entry, one of the three American Le Mans teams that ended up sweeping the biggest endurance race on the calendar, the 24 Hours of Le Mans. Peterson White Lightning winning it at Le Mans. Stay with us. We'll be right back to Mid-Ohio for more on CBS. Tonight on CBS, 26 years ago, a Philadelphia disco burned to the ground. Now, the discovery of a missing victim could help prove this was no accident. Don't miss TV's most watched new drama, Cold Case, tonight at 8, 7 Central on CBS, America's most watched network. Well, there's been a big change in driver lineups, and some of them are out. Calvin Fish has caught up with two that had a great tussle on the racetrack.
Well, after turning the wheel over to Chris Dyson and Andy Wallace, that was a great first stint there. You literally had a great dust-up with Marco Werner. Talk us through it.
Actually, it was a brilliant race. I mean, obviously, the traffic in these ALMS races is what makes the race. You can pull a gap, and then suddenly, boff, it's gone again. It means that there's a new race every two or three laps when you trip over somebody. It's a fantastic start. I have to say, the team did such a great job in the winter to work really hard on the performance of the car and obviously got it up to a good level, and Goodyear have given us some great tires. Every lap they got better and better, so I was really, really happy.
We've got Marco Werner here. Marco coming over to have a chat with Andy. It was a great battle, Marco.
That's racing, that's funny. Very nice. I can drive 2 hours more. It was so funny. Really good. That was motorsport.
That's what ALMS is all about. That is awesome. Guys?
GT leader is in. Timo Bernhard got out. Jörg Bergmeister is back in the car, but a race off pit lane. And it looks like the Peterson White Lightning car got out in front of the Alex Job car as they left on around on the first round of pit stops, guys.
Wow, so the Le Mans winning team now out front here in Mid-Ohio.
Wow, the racing is not only on the track, it's even coming down pit lane. That's always a good bit of ego for the pit crews, that you set yourself up to try and beat the guys right next to you because you want to be the best. You want to not only be the winning car, but you want to be the best pit crew.
And pit lane might be the story here today. We've seen that turning things around in P1 as well as in the GTS class now, where Ron Fellows is out in front in the number three Corvette over Olivier Moretta. So things are really getting exciting. A change on pit lane in the GT class as well.
Just that one little incident right there and how it happened, the timing of the incident before the pace car came out. It appears to have given Ron Fellows a one lap lead in his GTS class. So the familiar number three Corvette is leading by a full lap, and that's a bonus, an unexpected bonus for him.
We're back to green and JJ Lato and the Audi out in front now as Chris Dyson tries to get the lead back.
JJ Lato, all last year we saw, is just, he's brilliant on the starts. It's not like a warming up process for him. It's almost like a switch. He's in the pits, cold at one point, the switch goes off, and he's instantly up to this blistering speed.
Hammer down right away.
Oh, gosh. A lot of talent.
There you see Chris Dyson running right behind him. And we really need to comment, too, Bill, on what this Dyson team did. While everybody else was at Le Mans, these guys went testing, and more testing. Tested here, tested in Lime Rock. What a difference and what a performance upgrade that team has found on the pole here, running in the lead for majority of the race and challenging for the win.
Well, last year we saw an indication of the speed of this particular package because they had that wonderful win back at Infineon Raceway, Sears Point, California. They were on the pole at Mosport, so on high-speed flowing circuits, this is a very, very quick car, and the only thing that seemed to hold them back was the Goodyear tires deteriorating over a long run or just little reliability problems that all new cars have.
The other thing is, Bill, when you look at the schedule this year, it really favors the Dyson boys a little bit better. We've lost two of the stop-and-go circuits on the schedule, Miami and Trois-Rivières, and we've added here at Mid-Ohio and Lime Rock. So I think when you look at the way the circuits line up this year, they could have a bit more of an advantage than they did last.
And also at Infineon, where we saw them very strong last year, the next race you'll see here on CBS Sports later this summer. The GTS class, well, it's all Corvette out front. Johnny O'Connell now behind the wheel of the number three, and Olivier Moretta chasing him in second place in the number four car. Well, the driver that just got out of the number three, Ron Fellows, is standing by with Tracy Wilson.
Well, Ron, you got a lucky break right there.
Well, it would seem that way, wouldn't it? Yeah. It's still early. We've still got probably about an hour and 15 to go. Again, right now it's a battle between the two Corvettes. This is kind of cool because we got a pile of people from CompuWare here, Pratt Miller and GM Racing. This is as good as a home race for us. So this is a good little battle, but we'll take luck whenever we can get it.
What is it like battling against your teammates?
Tough. Oliver's been flying all weekend, and we did the best we could to keep up. I got caught out with about 10 to go with a couple of prototypes. I got offline, had a bunch of pickup on my tires, and lost a bunch of ground. But hey, we'll take this little lucky break, and hopefully Johnny's going to be fine and bring it home. I want to say hi to Dale Jr. and Michael. Good luck out there at Sonoma. All the DEI crew. We miss being there, but. This is it's great being here in Mid-Ohio.
Thanks a lot, Ron.
Thanks, Tracy.
Now, the one thing that Ron talked about, pickup on the tires, just to explain what that is, that you'll see on the edges of the track, little black dots, as the rubber comes off the tires, it forms these little particles of rubber. When they hook onto an ultra-hot race tire, they stick, and it's just like driving your street car when the wheels are badly out of balance.
And the concrete helps make a lot of those marbles that we're seeing.
For sure.
And we heard Ron Fellows talk about Dale Earnhardt Jr. We'll be seeing Dale Earnhardt Jr. behind the wheel, this very number three Corvette, with his teammate Boris Shedd at our next race here on CBS at Infineon Raceway coming up later this summer. Another one of the events that took place here earlier this weekend, the Star Mazda Series.
CBS Sports coverage of American Le Mans at Mid-Ohio is sponsored by Mazda. Always the soul of a sports car.
The racing continues here at Mid-Ohio with the American Le Mans Series, America's premier sports car racing series. And Here are our four class leaders, four classes, four race winners, all in one race. J.J. Lato leading the premier class, the P1 division. Robin Liddell making a tremendous debut here this weekend, running with Clint Field. They are leading in P2. Corvette dominating in GTS, where Johnny O'Connell and Ron Fellows have teamed up to take the lead there. And Johannes van Overbeek, it's a Porsche out front in GT, but not maybe the one you would have expected.
Nah, it's really surprising that this is a fairly major upset, that Alex Job's team really have had the rule of this kingdom for a number of years now, and suddenly he's being challenged very seriously by this other team.
On board with the P1 leader, this is J.J. Lato, the great Finnish driver. Watch how his head goes up and down here, Bill. It really is an example of the forces that these drivers go under.
Yeah, we'll get an ID here as he goes through the corner. You can just see right about there is the helmet, and then it actually goes up as he's pushing hard on the throttle. You'll see it go above that line, then watch under braking. Goes right back down. Now, he swears that he gets the pit crew to clamp down his harnesses as tight as possible, but somehow he's moving around the cockpit.
And he's got a huge lead over the car that's running in second, Chris Dyson. The Dyson Racing entry is now two laps down to J.J. Lato.
Yeah, and for our viewers that are maybe seeing these kind of cars for the first time, the lights that you see on the top of the dashboard, those are the lights that take the place of a tachometer in this car, telling them when it shifts.
And here's why. While we were away, and J.J. and Chris were having quite a battle for the lead position, as Chris now works his way through traffic, Chris just lost it.
Yeah, it's a fairly quick part of the track right there. The car is doing a transition from left to right. He has come over the crest of the hill, so things are fairly light. It's an easy place to do it. First thing he did was get back on the radio, call the crew, and apologize for making a mistake. He's a young man that has got a wealth of ability, and he's doing so well in this. But how nice to think of the crew at a time like that instead of himself.
There's the packed hillside at the S's, one of the key sections, one of the more famous sections of Mid-Ohio, and there is Chris Dyson. As we said, this team has done so much testing, so much work. Even though they're two laps down right now, they have to be thrilled with the performance upgrades they've seen here this weekend. Sitting on the pole, challenging for the win, leading the first half of the race. They're going to be strong at Lime Rock. We see them again on CBS at Infineon in a couple of weeks.
They will be extremely powerful down at Infineon. That's a track that maybe suits them even more than Mid-Ohio does. They'll be very, very competitive. But it's just as important for them to keep going today, because you don't know what's going to happen. I mean, we've seen some of the strangest things happen today with their team car, the number 16 car, going out on the pace lap, basically. So they have to keep going in case something fluky happens to that champion ADT Audi.
You just never know. You got to keep going until the checkered flag falls. Now, in the GT class, again, Porsche is out front, but as we said, not the Porsche team that you would expect. It's the Flying Lizard team. And you know, there's a little secret to that. Nobody really knows where the Flying Lizard came from. If you ask any of the guys on the team, the drivers, the crew members, none of them know. The only people that know are the actual principal owners of the team, and they're not saying.
Well, the good thing about the 45 team, guys, they've been testing and testing and testing during the offseason. And one of the things that Alex Job told me when I was talking to him the other day, he said, we've never won here at Mid-Ohio. And I got to tell you, it's going to be a lot of hard work for us to win here this weekend. We think the only car that's out there that can beat us is the 45 Flying Lizard. We're seeing it out there one more time. Alex Job having a hard time bringing a victory home here at Mid-Ohio.
Bill, one thing I got from talking to Alex Job over the weekend, he said while a lot of these teams went to Le Mans, and some of the teams like Flying Lizard went testing, they went back and worked on their equipment, figured out how to make their cars easier to service, how to make things work better for them while they're on the road for this long stretch of races. The Alex Job team's going to be on the road for 10 solid weeks.
This is going to be an endurance contest all unto itself, just for the crews to try and maintain it.
Yeah, and he feels like maybe we might not win the championship necessarily just with our performance on the track, but off of it during this 10-week stint.
Yeah, the Flying Lizard team really have been very impressive throughout this entire weekend. At one point during the practice sessions, they were sitting first and fourth on the grid, both with very, very quick times. And then it was one of those fluky things happened. The Lamborghini happened to spin at the wrong place, came back on the track as their other car was going by, and a big wreck ensued. That was not the same car what we saw earlier in that little incident with David Salins. They had to pull their back-out car, not nearly as good. Tried to get out of the race and run with that one, but they are a very good team.
We've spent a lot of time talking about the Porsches in GT. There is a lone Ferrari running in this division, which Ralph Kellner's and Anthony Lazzaro, the Rizzi Competizione entry. It's a Ferrari 360 Modena GTC, and they've been having a very good run. Unfortunately, they had problems while Lazzaro was behind the wheel. There you see the car parked off the side of the course. We were able to tap into the radio conversation while Anthony explained the problem.
Here's my tire. I put it back on, hit the keyhole, and then going up through the gears, it died. I immediately switched the map off. I reset the ignition, reset the master, turned the fuel pumps back off. Nothing. Something in the starter's turning, but it's like the starter motor's either turning by itself, but I've never heard it by itself like that, or hitting the flywheel and just spinning the flywheel over.
And trouble for the 79 car. This is the J3 Racing Porsche 911 GT3 RSR. Justin Jackson behind the wheel, and they've got a flat tire in the GT class. And Bill, let's go back to the Ferrari just for a second. Obviously some interesting problems that he's trying to diagnose, but also really intriguing is all the things he has to run through, how difficult it is to really get one of these things started and rolling.
Well, to try and get it moving again, and it's one of the downsides of modern technology. This is a Ferrari that has the paddle shift, just the little flaps behind the steering wheel for shifting up through the gears or downshifting. In a conventional car, you simply move the lever into neutral, wiggle it around, and you've got a pretty good idea that you can do it. In that car, it's a lot tougher, and you heard Anthony telling the crew chief that he had gone through the entire sequence to try and reset the car's brain box, the computer inside the car, with no success.
No problem so far for J.J. Lehto. He's having a very solid run. Now, we're hearing a lot about what Audi might be doing in the near future, and one of the things I'm getting from some of my sources within the American Le Mans series is that Audi is committed to this series for the next few years. We should be seeing the R8 back again here next year. And then, Bill, very exciting news that in 2006, we should be seeing an R9 or maybe even a newer evolution, an R10. And I'm hearing the word diesel bantered about.
I could tell you more on it, but I'd have to kill you.
Should be very interesting to see where Audi takes their racing program. Let's head down to Brian.
Well, we talked about the 45 Flying Lizard car, Darren Law sharing that car with Johannes van Overbeek. And I think maybe the best compliment to you guys and what's happening right now, we said earlier, Alex Jobe said, we think the only car out there that can beat us is the 45 Flying Lizard.
Actually, I think we can. We've had unbelievable run. The car's super consistent. When I came in right behind the Jobe car, and we beat him out of the pit. So the team has done a phenomenal job. It's been a good weekend.
And I know you were fired up when you got out of the car. The guys are doing a great pit stop, like you said. Any problems at all with the car right now?
Yeah, we've got a minor issue. The brakes are a little spongy, but I think that was because I spent, 30 laps behind David Murray with no air getting to the thing. So other than the brakes, the car is just running beautiful. It's very good.
Obviously, it's very good, guy. Leading GT right now in the car, it looks hooked up.
Monday, Dave's all new on CBS with Piedmont Bird Callers, plus Spider-Man 2 star Kirsten Dunst. And later this week, don't miss Will Ferrell. Dave's all new, all this week on CBS, America's most watched network. Well, we said it's a blockbuster summer for the American Le Mans Series, and we've talked to some of the drivers about their favorite movie clips and favorite movie lines.
I like the movie Dinosaur, which probably many of you have not heard unless you have a lot of little kids around the house, which I do, a three-year-old son. We watched Dinosaur, and the line there about T-Rex is, what's a T-Rex? A mouthful of teeth with a bad attitude.
My favorite movie would have to be Le Mans with Steve McQueen, and I guess the movie line would be winning or racing is life, everything else is just waiting.
They say the American Le Mans Series is European-style racing with an American attitude. Well, that Corvette that's leading the GTS class is 7 liters of big old bad American attitude right there.
That looks kind of like the new car that you just ordered today, isn't it? The one that you phoned home to tell your wife about. Right?
Getting me in trouble.
Beautiful car. These things are so well thought out. Make no mistake, folks, they kind of look like what you see on the street, but these are beautifully developed race cars by all the guys at Pratt & Miller.
You know, one of the things you noticed as you looked at our GTS leaderboard there is that David Brabham is up to third. The Lamborghini Murcielago up to third.
Alone, now that we've just jinxed him by saying he's up to third, he is in the pits right here. And the quick report that I just got is that they are transmission or drivetrain problems. This car, it's really kind of interesting because the engine basically is set up in the car backwards. There's a drive, the gearbox is up in the cockpit, so it goes from the engine forward to the cockpit, and then out of the gearbox, there's then a drive shaft that runs back to the rear axle. So for those water skiers out there that have V-drive boats, that's almost what this car looks like.
Okay, we can't see anything obvious. If it's not right, park it.
Yeah, there were two of those that showed up here this weekend, the other one being driven by Tracy Krohn and Scott Maxwell in the Krohn-Barber Racing entry. And that car got involved in an incident back on Friday, so unfortunately it was not going to be able to compete here today.
Boy, these guys, if they've been so pleased with Pirelli tires also on that Lamborghini.
Now, earlier today, there was trouble for the 4 and the 63. Olivier Beretta in the 4 car battling with the Saline. Contact down at the keyhole.
Johnny Molum in that car right there at that's about as close as you want to come to the tire wall.
Look at the damage to the front. That's going to mean a visit to the pits as he works his way through Thunder Valley.
Yeah, I mean, that's something they want to try and take.
There it goes. Well, maybe not.
I guess they don't have to try and take down any longer.
Skip the pits.
He's going to lose a fair bit of front downforce in that because he's lost that nice ramping effect of the air going up across the front of the car. So maybe faced with a bit of a push problem in that the front end just won't turn very well on high-speed corners.
The street version of that car is worth about $475,000. About $75,000 worth of hood just went over the fence.
Yeah, I think so. That's the, that's the car that God drove, so beautiful car. What was that movie?
Hewlett, look at the front, please. Look in the front.
Working on the car. It was a Jim Carrey movie.
Bruce Almighty. Had to come to me sooner or later.
There you go, Johnny.
Now, we do hear that there's a possibility of a second Saline also appearing before the year is out.
There you go, Johnny. Starting to go.
The folks at Saline have spent a lot of time developing the street version of this car and their Mustangs that they do as well. So they're trying to get back their racing program back to the front. And as soon as you get this car dialed in, we hear the next one should be coming out. So this car now making its way back to the front.
Well, the first one I ever drove, my first automobile that I ever drove, was actually a Sept 600, which was my mother's, which I used to steal out of her garage and take down on private roads. I have to say private, they're actually public roads, it's illegal, but if I say private, then it's okay. The police can't arrest me. And I was about 8 years old, and she never knew I took it. And I used to crash it regularly, and for some reason she never realized, maybe she did know actually thinking about it, but I used to go off and through bushes because it didn't have, the steering never centralized itself, so I'd go around a corner and I wouldn't be able to straighten up quick enough and it'd carry on turning. And I was struggling to reach the pedals at the same time, so I used to basically just go and do like a banger racing in this car with my friends. And so that was the first car I ever drove. The first car I ever actually owned officially was a Volkswagen Golf, which I also ran into the ground and had numerous accidents in.
Swiping your mom's car. Maybe that's why she used to wrap your lunch in road maps, Johnny.
And he's still having trouble keeping his cars all together, isn't he? Here today.
Is this something new? Yeah, I didn't have this before. Listen to it as I come by.
So now they're having some sort of noise that they're hearing.
Well, I would think there'd be a lot of aerodynamic noise among the things. And plus, the lift on that nose has got to be pretty severe. See the leader just went by there, the ADT champion car, and there is Chris Dyson right behind him. Good thing that hood didn't fly off and one of those fellows is around. One of the few times you don't want to be in an open car when there's chunks and bits flying around the racetrack.
Johnny is listed fourth overall in GTS right now as we watch Leto in the Audi. And we hear that there's a possibility we could see a second one of these Audis before the year is out. In fact, sooner than later.
Yeah, I know that's something they are working on with the sponsors to bring the second car out. And there's a lot of talk about some very high-profile drivers to win the second Audi. So the champion people are looking to bring even more exotic racing to these tracks. again, just for viewers at home that have maybe never watched the Audi R8 before, what you're seeing right in this area here, these lights coming across the dashboard, are the shift lights. And they know when the engine gets to high RPM and the red lights appear, that's when they want to shift. Just little paddle shifts right behind the wheel, and that's what JJ's working with.
Tonight on 60 Minutes, why, if a Patriot missile can't always distinguish between an enemy missile and an American plane, are we still using them? 60 Minutes tonight. Our Porsche mail to web aerial cam, there is a look at your P1 standings. Top three, JJ Leto and Chris Dyson, your top two. Stay with us. Back to Mid-Ohio, where J.J. Leto is still out front leading in P1. The Audi R8 having a tremendous run here today. You know, the only piece of the car that actually touches the road is the tires. Here's Brian Till with our Michelin tire tip.
A lot of fans at home may be familiar with the terms tire construction and tire compound. Construction, just the way the tires put together, and the compound, how grippy and how durable the rubber is. But what you may not be as familiar with is the science behind tire inflation. Take these techs here at the Michelin tent. They're filling these race tires with nitrogen, not standard air, because nitrogen has a lot less humidity to it. Now, if you were to fill one of these race tires with standard air and take it from ambient air temperature to the 200 plus degrees it'll see during competition, you'd find that the tire pressure would grow by 10 to 12 pounds. Now, conversely, fill it with nitrogen, that tire inflation will only grow by 6 to 8 pounds. Now, every half pound of inflation is worth handling on the racetrack, so the inflation is absolutely critical. Now, the tire technology that you have in your street tires at home is every bit as sophisticated as the tire technology found in these race tires. So inflation is important on your car too, not only for the way the car handles, but to make sure you have a safe trip home.
And those tire technicians will be checking those tires 30, 40 times a day. And they suggest you should probably check yours at least once a month for the road.
It is so important that so few people do it. And I'm afraid I'm one of the guilty ones too, that I rarely check the tires on my street car, but very important.
There's your P2 leader, Robin Liddell, behind the wheel, having a great run today as he debuts with Clint Field in the Intersport Racing entry, the Lola B2K 40 Judd. Calvin?
Well, it's been quite a month for this young man, Clint Field from Columbus, Ohio. Clint, winning Le Mans a couple of weeks ago, 21 years old. What was that like for you?
It was an unbelievable experience. I mean, first of all, just to go to race in that legendary race is unbelievable. So to win it on my first try is something that probably I'll never be able to do again in any race. So
certainly would be great to cap it off here with a win on your local track. Robin is behind the wheel now. You drafted him in this weekend, and he's immediately taken to the car and is very fast, it looks like.
Yeah, no, Robin's a great driver. You know, he did some Porsche stuff last year and did some single-seater stuff before that, but he's a great driver, a great guy. And I got to thank Pirelli for putting that together, because they're helping us out, and we hope to have him in some more this year.
Certainly looking forward to that. The team is now gearing up. They do have one final pit stop to make. And as Clint mentioned, it was the Pirelli tire folks that got Robin Liddell this deal for hopefully more races this year as well.
Well, the way this is going today, Bill, I would think they would be anxious to make this combination run the rest of the season. In fact, Clint is the only one of the Le Mans winners that's leading his class today. Second place from GT on pit road. Brian?
Jörg Bergmeister brings the car in. This stop is early. They thought for a while they may be even able to stretch fuel to the end. Timo Bernhard will take over, but it seems like they have some type of a fuel pickup problem. They're not able to run the tank all the way to the bottom, so they're going to have to come in and top this car off. They'll go ahead and put Bernhard in. He's the one who qualified this car, and they will do tires. Once again, tire wear here has been an issue, so they'll put fresh tires on this car, fill it with fuel, and that should take Timo Bernhard to the end. But one more time, seems like Alex Job is going to come up on the short end of the stick with a victory here at Mid-Ohio. Ralph?
Johannes Van Overbeek continues to lead in GT, the number 45 Flying Lizard car. And why do you think it is that Alex Job Racing just is snake bit, or lizard bit maybe today, here in Mid-Ohio?
Yeah, you know, I don't know. It's one of those incredible things that sometimes you watch an NFL game, there's certain teams and they will...
What is the fuel pressure, people?
Let's just listen.
Fuel use.
Why does he need to know what the fuel pressure is? What is he checking for?
I think they just want to make sure they're getting the fuel picked up right away. They might have had a fuel pressure warning come on.
Turn your blinker off. Turn your blinker off.
He's just signaling he's going to turn pretty soon. That's all. Boy, and there's a flying lizard car right behind Timo. I think he was doing everything he could to avoid going another lap down right there. He did that block deliberately. That was not a casual cut across the path by being inattentive. That was very deliberate and probably smart on his part.
Yep, that is Johannes van Overbeek, the GT class leader, right there in that silver and red number 45.
Interesting. When these cars, when they crest that rise like there, we're actually seeing air under the front tires.
As long as you don't get split by the overall leader and he gets his lap back, we're fine. He can sit on his bumper.
And here comes Dyson slicing through as he works his way through running second in P1. Let's check in what is going on in P2. Here is a car that is actually running in second in P2. Andy Lally running along in second position in that car right now. Driver out of Northport, New York. That's the race car company entry, Lola B2K40.
Looking very much at home around the track here. Andy is sometimes a teammate of mine. Really nice young guy. Very quick in the car, very precise. Much like Robin Liddell that we watched. I mean, watching these fellas here and what they try to do, what every race driver tries to do, sometimes unsuccessfully, is to basically do the same thing lap after lap after lap. You want to be very, very consistent with the car. Take it to the same place in the track, get under the throttle at the same place, brake at the same place.
And here is a car that is running back in third in this class, the P2 class. This is the entry number 10, the Miracle Motorsports machine. Miracle Lola B2K40, James Gouet behind the wheel. And they're actually the one team running on Yokohama tires in this class. And they were telling me earlier they thought maybe they would be able to go the entire distance on one set of Yokohama tires, something they've been working hard on Yokohama with. And the Audi is on pit road. J.J. Leto, their second stop of the afternoon. Calvin.
J.J. brings it in. We believe J.J. will stay behind the wheel. I see Marco Bona just sitting there with no helmet on. That is an immediate sign. You notice on this car that they're refueling from the right side. Now, this car was designed for Le Mans where the pits boxes are actually on the other side of the car, so they have to actually pull that over the side of the car. They say that costs them about 2 seconds on one of these pit stops. It takes about 28 seconds to get a full fuel load in. They may shortchange him a little bit there. No tire change. J.J. back underway.
That was a nice stop, very efficiently done. JJ sitting there, very cool and calm. Sometimes you'll hear people come in and they'll be revving and looking around frantically. Leto is just the consummate professional. He was just sitting there minding his own business until it was time to leave the pits once again. He has always been such fun to watch and virtually every car he's raced back in the days of the BMW McLaren F1, and even when he was with the BMW team in the early years of the American Le Mans Series. Great driver.
Well, that's your P1 leader. Let's dip back and find your P2 leader. There it is, the blue number 30 out front. Robin Liddell having a solid run out front. And Monday on CBS, see why critics say that CSI Miami is fascinating, slick, and powerful. Don't miss Monday's most watched show, CSI Miami, Monday at 10, 9 Central on CBS, America's most watched network. And a look at our leaderboard of Robin Liddell and Andy Lally chasing him. And we talked to some of our drivers about their favorite movies and their favorite lines from the film industry.
Favorite movie would probably be Blues Brothers. And favorite line from that would be, "I hate Illinois Nazis."
My favorite movie is probably The Road Warrior. And probably my favorite line from a movie is one of Mel Gibson's few lines in that movie where he goes and tells everybody, "You want out of here? Talk to me."
Monday on CBS begins with Still Standing and Yes, Dear. Then the Emmy Award-winning Everybody Loves Raymond and the new hit, 2 and a Half Men. Followed by Monday's number one drama, CSI Miami. Plus The Late Show with David Letterman. Monday, right here on America's Most Watched Network. High above our GTS leader, the Chevrolet Corvette being driven by Johnny O'Connell. By the way, June 30th is Drive Your Vet to, or Corvette's original birthday. Friday was Drive Your Vet to Work Day, which Johnny O'Connell is doing today. Now, Dale Earnhardt Jr., we told you, is going to be running this exact car at Infineon Raceway in a couple of weeks, which is here on CBS. He recently went and tested with the team at Gingerman Raceway in Michigan. He was just as quick as Ron Fellows, along with his teammate Boris said. The biggest difference, Bill, was the braking, getting used to the carbon brakes.
Yeah, these cars do have phenomenal brakes, and we've seen it. It's so impressive hearing that he went that fast, because both Boris and Ronnie Fellows particularly, they know this car inside and out. But I am really looking forward to meeting Dale Jr. He's a young man I've always wanted to meet.
He's a great guy, and he has a tremendous collection of Corvettes. And of course, you will see that race right here from Infineon on CBS, July 18th, 3 p.m. Eastern Time. It should be a spectacular weekend of American Le Mans Series racing. Now, next week, the American Le Mans Series moves on to a very small, tight, twisty racetrack out in Lakeville, Connecticut, Lime Rock Park, New England Grand Prix. You'll see that live on Speed Gen.
Very conservative pass right there, as he should be doing at this stage of the race.
The Corvettes that we're seeing here today are actually last year's model. These cars stayed here while the new version went to Le Mans and went 1-2 over there. The new cars will be back in time for Infineon, and Dale Jr. is actually going to run one of last year's model, which is the car leading here today.
Yeah, there's obviously nothing wrong with these cars. Boy, they go around these tracks so well. You look at them and their ability to turn it. Oh, here's Chris Dyson in the pits.
Yep, Chris Dyson bringing the second place car from P1 down on pit road. Calvin Fish.
And you heard the manager there, Kelsey, say shut the car off. The car has to be turned off. It cannot be fired with the engine running when they're doing the refueling. Another part of these rules for ALMS competition. This should be a short fill, just as we saw with the champion car. We've only got about 25 minutes left in this event to go, so he doesn't need a full fuel load. Chris now gets the okay to fire it up. A little bit of a delay here, which is always one of the big problems. The car has to fire up under its own steam. You cannot have a push start here. And finally, Chris gets it running, and he's clearing back on the way.
Chris has done a very nice job since he's been in that car. He's been running very, very nice lap times, very consistent. Other than that one spin he had.
And now we see one of the Corvettes on pit road. Calvin Fish right there.
And that's Olivier Beretta in the car. He's going to stay in. And as we expect at this stage, that these guys will stay on the Michelins. They do. They only have the longest in left. So Olivier Beretta just the top of the fuel. He's back underway. See if he can chase down his teammate, Johnny O'Connell, in the number three.
Doug Feehan, the man that oversees the Corvette program, told me that the difference between this version
20 minutes left in the race, 20 minutes.
And the new version of the C5 Corvette, C5R, that we'll be seeing, the ones that just won at Le Mans, is only about 0.2 seconds. And really, the biggest difference is in the ease of maintenance for the crew working on the cars.
Yeah, and that's something the crew all love, because there's nothing worse than having to spend 4 or 5 hours to replace something that should maybe take you 10 minutes.
Of course, I asked Doug about the C6. This is the C5 version of the Chevrolet Corvette, the sixth generation of the car, debuting in your showrooms coming this fall. And we asked him if they're going to be racing the C6. He said, I can't confirm it yet, but I can tell you we have not been sitting idly by. My guess, it's built, it's ready, and we should be seeing it at Sebring.
A politician at heart.
I think one of the biggest exciting announcements out of the GTS class coming soon, and we expect to see it also appearing at Sebring in 2005, is the Aston Martin DB9. Now, my sources tell me that car's built. They've actually touched it, seen it, felt it. It exists and ready to go racing. And that should be fantastic to see the Aston Martin battling with Lamborghini and Corvette.
It will be good, because I know the Aston is
coming to turn 10, 10 in this lap, 10 in this lap.
Oh, coming in.
That's Johnny.
Coming back in.
Both pumps on. Both pumps on.
Johnny O'Connell coming down pit lane here, so this is going to be a very fast.
Leave the brake fans on. As you roll in here, turn the ignition off, turn the ignition back on. Turn your AC off.
It's a lot to think about when you've been racing
and
so fast.
On the board.
As you try to slow your brain down for the pit stop. Let's head down to pit stop. Calvin.
Johnny hits his marks. He turns the engine off as requested, and now they're just going to top up with fuel again. There should be no tire change here. This is the team that won the 12 Hours of Sebring, along with Max Pappas, Johnny O'Connell, and Ron Fellows. One down there to the unbeaten in ALMS competition. They had a second-place run at the 24 Hours of Sebring. He's back underway.
Now, if you wonder why put a fuel fill down so low on the side of the car, you're using gravity to help you just that tiny bit. They go for every single thing possible to try and help me make the pit stops as short as possible. Rather than being on top of the car as opposed to the side, just gives them that tiny little advantage.
And one thing with the Dyson Racing Team, Bill, for many years I used to watch Rob Dyson come here with two cars and only have one fueling rig. And I'm like, why would he compromise his pit stop with only having one fueling rig? And the officials didn't catch on to it either. Because it was gravity fed, they were putting twice the amount of fuel in one tank and get a quicker stops done. So they were a little bit sneaky there and got away with it for a long time.
It's only cheating if you get caught, right?
That's it.
We had an opportunity to speak to Johnny O about what the most important word in the English language is to him.
Loyalty, I would say, would be a very important word. Loyalty and integrity. My whole family, we do the martial arts, and words like that mean a lot to you. And they're, you know, if you can conduct yourself with loyalty towards others and integrity towards others and yourself, I think no matter what you do, you'll be successful.
All right, we're back to the racing action as Corvette now continues to lead here with Johnny O'Connell out in front. For year-round sports coverage with late-breaking news and the best fantasy games on the internet, go to cbssportsline.com. Log on to americanlemans.com as well for live timing and scoring. Enter the Monterey, California Getaway Sweepstakes presented by Pirelli. You can win a trip to the American Le Mans season finale in Laguna Seca in October, as well as other great prizes. AmericanLeMansSeries.com or AmericanLeMans.com.
And that's a great race, finishing up the year at Mazda Raceway, Laguna Seca. Boy, that's be, wow, there's class leaders right there.
Class leaders having at it right here. In our class leaderboard, looks like this. J.J. Leto out in front in P1, Clint Field in P2. Stay with us. And Le Mans Corvette had a tremendous run up and down through the night. They had to basically rebuild both cars after having trouble on the racetrack. But they came back, got the cars together, and found their way to victory lane once again, just like they're trying to do here at Mid-Ohio. Stay with us. We'll be right back on CBS. Tonight on TV's most watched new drama, 26 years ago, a Philadelphia disco burned to the ground. Now, the discovery of a missing victim could help prove this was no accident. Don't miss Cold Case tonight at 8, 7 Central on CBS, America's most watched network. The American Le Mans Series family wants to pass along our best wishes to IMSA official Bob Fleurschutz, who's a regular with the series, who's a little under the weather. Bob, we know you're watching. Hurry up and get back to the track. On board with J.J. Leto in the Audi. It's a Porsche digital pilot, and well, as we watch this car going around, some hoping maybe soon we'll be seeing Porsche competing with Audi. And what I'm hearing from the Porsche officials is that there's big meetings coming up at Porsche in July and October to seriously discuss what their racing plans are with the series.
Well, you and I and a couple of million other people are all hoping that Porsche do this as well, because it's something that's been sadly missed over the years, where we don't have a Porsche that can compete for an overall victory. These the GT3Rs are spectacularly great race cars in the GT class. They're basically based on a production street car and then heavily modified for racing.
I'll give you a plus sign here coming up, all right?
But now we're talking about a flat-out purebred race car, and oh, I hope.
And these are factory-assisted as we watch our GT class leader here. The Flying Lizard team, they've made their final pit stop and they are still leading. And with more on that story, here's Brian Till.
It was indeed their final pit stop, but it was almost the end of the race for those guys. Called it very, very, very closely. The car actually out of gas, running down pit lane. They, too, were having a fuel pickup problem, much like the Alex Job cars. So it was very close for those guys. Victory in their grasp, and they almost let it slip through their fingers, Ralph.
All right, Brian. We continue to watch Johannes van Overbeek leading in GT. I would also tell you real quickly that we've also heard, as we talk about some of the exciting things that are coming to the American Le Mans Series, there's a major Japanese manufacturer who is coming to ALMS, and you might be a bit surprised as to exactly which class they've chosen to enter to put their support in. We have not been able to break that news just yet, but we can tell you they're coming. A lot of good things happening over here.
This car all day long has really impressed me just how stable it looks. I mean, you watch this thing go through the bumps and over the whoop-de-doos, and the car looks beautiful at all points. So credit to these guys for all their hard work in developing and testing while others were at Le Mans. It's paying off for them.
Well, the racing has settled down just a little bit. As you see the class-leading Corvette right behind the class-leading GT entry. So while things have settled a little bit, let's show you a foot cam. There's the car that you're on board with. This is the number 24 Porsche.
And you'll notice something different very early on, that the right foot, the left foot giving confidence taps on the brake. Make sure the brake pressure is right up there when he needs braking. But watch when his right foot is on the throttle and then listen to the sound and never see it back off.
This is Romain Dumas.
You can hear the sound. The engine does stop just for a brief fraction of a second. This is all part of the program. Again, the left foot brakes. Then eventually he uses the right foot for the heavy braking. The left foot is really just making sure there's pressure built up in that pedal.
Bill, for those that are new to sports car racing, we see him kind of angle his foot over and actually tap the gas at the same time, something called heel and toe.
Yeah, and that's something that's slowly and surely going away, too, because now a lot of the onboard computers on these race cars will automatically look the throttle for you, just to kick the RPM up so that when the clutch lets out and the next gear you've gone down to, it doesn't suddenly drag the car sideways by locking up the rear axle.
And sometimes, while he's even going down the straightaway, we see him tapping the brake. Watch.
With just confidence taps. These are just things that sometimes, as your brakes get worn down in your street car, your brake pedal will get lower and lower and closer to the floor. You don't want that in a race car. You want to keep it up as high as possible just for that one benefit, and that you can then roll your foot to hit the gas pedal. So you want as much pressure as possible. He's building the pressure there. Just a one quick little stab. That looks like a flying lizard on the floor. Right down there. It's
just... Well, that piece of grass is sliding all around the cockpit. You can tell when he's accelerating or braking by which direction the grass is sliding.
You know, and based on the number of taps of that left foot, I think he is having a little bit of brake fade, and the brakes weren't nearly as strong at this point in the race as they were early on.
And Bill, one other thing, as you look at the cockpit, this is the only thing right here that is actually keeping some of the heat from the underside of the car away from the driver. A very sparse cockpit. It shows you just how light they try to make the cars, and well, how little there is to keep the drivers from dealing with the heat.
And another one of the wonderful things about the Porsche, there's lots, but maybe one of the best, is with the rear engine, they're a lot cooler to drive than the Corvette is, for example. The Corvette and the old Dodge Viper used to just fry drivers' feet down in that foot box.
But their cockpits would still look similar.
Yes, oh yeah, Baron. You want to take all flammable material out. You want to make these cars as safe as possible. Get all that insulation out of the way. And hey, it's only a driver. He's paid to be home.
So that is what's going on in GT right now with Romain Dumas, who looks to be running 7th in GT right now.
This was the car that early on we heard was having some sort of a notchy gearbox problem. Just the car wasn't shifting as cleanly as possible, although it sounds okay right now.
And there is the Celine with Johnny Mollum on board. That car running 4th in GTS, and he is trying to track down David Brabham. There's Johnny right there.
And pretty close, too. We're showing like about 3.5 seconds back, and he's running a little bit faster than Brabham is right now in the Lamborghini, so this could be a good battle in a couple of laps.
So the Murcielago having a great debut, running 3rd overall in GT.
Well, they said when the car was actually debuted in Europe that it actually led the race for quite a while before finally going on to finish in third place. So that's good things for Lamborghini.
That was in Valencia, Spain. These cars actually arrived here. One came into Atlanta prior about a week before the race. The other one literally in a crate to the doorstep here at Mid-Ohio, where the team picked it up when they got here, the Chrome Barber Racing Team. Let's check in with Tracy Wolfson now with Terry Borcheller, the other driver of the Saleen.
Terry, Johnny's now just 3 seconds off. You were giving him some confidence boosters. What did you say to him?
Well, I was just boosting him up and telling him to go as hard as he could, keep the tires under him, and he's doing a great job. He's a pro, and I think he's going to get him, see if he can get by him. David's very experienced, too, so it should be good.
Obviously, the Corvette way ahead of this field. How are you going to catch up to them later on in the season?
I'm not sure. I don't know if we'll be able to, but we're going to try. Jeff Tignarelli has been working really hard. We've been testing a lot, and Pirelli's really stepped up to try to give us a tire. So we're trying. I don't know if we'll be able to do it, but we'll keep working at it and see how it ends up.
Thanks a lot, and good luck.
Hi to my family.
It's a new engine in this car, too, the Elan Motor company building the power plant for the Saleen. This is the first time they've used it. Seems to be going quite well, but look at this battle now brewing with them and Lamborghini.
He is catching it very quickly. Boy, you can see all down the side of the car how dirty it looks, that dark gray. That's carbon fiber material coming off the carbon brakes on the front. It's filthy black stuff. The crew hate it, but they are the best brakes in the world, and carbon brakes are on all of the top cars running today, whether it's the Audi R8 or the Porsche GT3s. They're on all the best cars.
This is the battle for third that we're watching for GT as the Saleen tries to close in on the Lamborghini. David Brabham behind the wheel of the GTS third place car right there, the Lamborghini.
Remaining, Bob. 5 minutes remaining.
Well, about 5 minutes remaining. You just heard it right there, and he is really busy trying to catch him. I thought we might be able to have a word with him, but certainly don't want to interrupt his concentration at this point. Both David Brabham and that Pirelli shot Lamborghini, as well as the Saleen here, are having a great battle.
Bill, we saw a puff of smoke out of the back of the Lamborghini, the first car in line here, as it came for braking down at the keyhole. Not really something to worry about. This car tends to belch a flame out of the back.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of smoke every once in a while all day long. It's just kicked a tiny little bit out. I think it's almost normal for the Italian motor at this point. It seems to be running perfectly. Again, like right there, that's just a little overrun. Just the timing, the computer and the motor is allowing just a fraction too much fuel to stay running in the engine. It actually gets into the hot exhaust and then ignites.
Boy, this is just what you want to see. Two of the most highly sought after exotics on the planet, having at it around a fantastic race course. And you can see how hard Brabham is pushing up on the curbing. V12 power in front of a V8.
Yeah, 6-liter V12 in the Lamborghini to 7-liter V8 in the Saleen.
Boy, you can hear the difference. With less than 4 minutes to go, can the Lamborghini Murcielago hold on for a tremendous third place finish here in GTS in their first race with the American Le Mans Series? And there are executives from Lamborghini here, so this would be a huge day for them.
Well, I don't know of anybody better that could be in that car right now other than David Brabham. He's been one of the crowd favorites.
Six of a second plus 0.6.
Now, here's the traffic that we talked about too, Bill. A slower GT car right in front of him.
That could come into play. David is really going to be very cagey here coming off the corner and get as much speed as possible, because you know the 7-liter in the Saleen is going to have tremendous American torque. The V12s. Oh, and he's got a terrific run on him. Look at this.
And a P2 car in front trying to squeeze him to the inside. Oh, almost took the nose off.
Let's see if David can come back now. Johnny made a great move there. Perfectly legal to do what he did by sliding over in front of David at that point. And I think that Saleen should have enough to stay in front of the Lamborghini at this point. But let's see.
The P2 car right in front of them.
Now, this may help Brabham right here. Look at David, closed right back up on him.
Well, they're going to pass right by the V2 car, the Van der Stoer car.
Boy, David Brabham really getting right back up under braking, closing the Lamborghini just up on the tail of the Saleen.
Good stop, Mr. Mollum, good stop.
You can hear the cheers of the team in the background.
Yeah, and just look at his eyes. Look at his body, how calm he looks.
That's Johnny Mullum in the orange helmet on your lower left, taking a quick look in the mirrors to see where that Lamborghini is. David Brabham running right behind him. The closing stages here as you're looking. There's the car, the number 63 Saleem. Johnny Mullum holds down third in GTS. David Brabham in the brand new Lamborghini Murcielago running behind him in fourth. What a tremendous battle in the closing stages here. Round two of the American Le Mans Series from mid-Ohio.
You'll also note Johnny Mullum with his right hand shifting a lot differently than you do in your street car.
Fuel light flickering.
Oh, boy.
Well, this might not be done yet.
No problem at all. No problem on fuel. White flag next time by.
Yeah, it's the right thing to say, even if he does have a problem.
Leader coming to the white flag. There's J.J. Lehto, the P1 class leader, taking the white flag.
ADT champion Audi has been flawless today. J.J. has just had that thing on cruise control, basically, since he took over from Mark Werner. Just running very consistent laps at this point. Watch down in the lower left corner of the Porsche Digital Pilot telemetry how fast this car accelerates down the straight. Like 100, 110, 120, 130. These cars, the American Le Mans prototype cars like this Audi, will accelerate from a dead stop to 100 miles an hour in around 5.5 seconds.
We've seen him carrying 2.5 G's through the corners at triple digit speeds. Just impressive.
Oh, it's amazing. These are the most advanced sports cars in the world.
Going by one of the GTS class leaders, it looked like that was Johnny O'Connell in the Corvette, the GTS class leader.
Now, as JJ comes around getting close to the checkered flag, just a little note of something. Talking about reliability and race engines, which sometimes don't go hand in hand. The engine in this car is the same engine that won the Miami Grand Prix last year, that won Petit Le Mans, 10 hours of racing, and Sebring.
And it just won at Mid-Ohio. Congratulations to J.J. Lehto and Marco Werner. The ADT champion team has won here at Mid-Ohio.
And look at Brabham.
There's your GT leader, the Porsche, and here's a battle in GTS for third. How's this going to shake out?
Ah, he's got it now.
I think what...
Oh, man, that was close.
Brabham not done yet as he sweeps around to the outside. The Lamborghini's still going to have a great run. Mullum's going to hold on for third.
Outstanding.
Lamborghini gets fourth, and Flying Lizard Racing wins in GT with Johannes van Overbeek, the driver behind the wheel to see the checkered flag. Johnny O'Connell takes the win in the Corvette as Corvette goes 1-2 in GTS. And Clint Field wins after winning at Le Mans a couple of weeks later. He wins here at his home track in P2. Stay with us. We'll talk to the winners when we come back.
CBS Sports coverage of American Le Mans at Mid-Ohio is sponsored by Audi. In technology, performance, and design, our goal remains constant. Never follow. And by Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
Well, the first sprint race of the 2004 American Le Mans Series season is over, and Audi has come out on front in P1, where J.J. Lehto and Marco Werner basically, Bill, did exactly what we expected, but had to work a little bit to get there, and Calvin Fish is with our win.
Well, it's a very happy J.J. Lehto. He's wiping up the sweat under his arms, and J.J., you assumed the lead during the pit stop, and from there it looked like cruise mode for the day.
Yeah, it was definitely when Dyson was in as well, and I don't know, they had a spin, and after that it was pretty easy, you know, there was no pushing at all. I just did a couple of faster laps, and then I was just saving the car throughout the race. It was a shame that the other number 16 Dyson was having a problem on the start and they couldn't take part into the race, because for sure they would have been challenging us even harder. So that's how it was today, you know. It was win for Audi and win for Champion Racing, and we are.
Looks like you're going to have a tough battle though on your hands. They go to their home track at Lime Rock next, and then you're off to Infineon, a track where they've won before, so you've certainly got a battle on your hands the rest of the season.
Well, for sure Lime Rock will be difficult. They have been testing there a lot. It's a home circuit for Dyson. They know the track very well. I don't know the track at all. Marco didn't either. So we both have to learn it. But Infineon, That's going to be different because last year we didn't have the right tires from Michelin, so I'm sure that this year it will be different.
I assume with the short hair and the facial hair going, that's your lucky charm now for the rest of the season?
Yeah, I can't do anything about it now. That's it. It's going to be like this for the rest of the season.
All right, mate, great job today.
Thank you.
Brian?
Well, GT class winners. We talked to Darren Law earlier, Johannes van Overbeek. Seemed to be a flawless run all day long for you guys, but right there at the end, the last stop, I think you were dead stick rolling up to the pit box.
Yeah, the car was absolutely dead. I got to thank the Flying Lizard crew. They've done an awesome job. The Shortell folks are out here, Brocade, East Silicon, and just couldn't do it. And Michelin. Tires hung in there great all day. Just couldn't have done it without them.
Now, you guys elected not to go to Le Mans. I know, Darren, both of you guys doing a lot of testing in between Sebring and here, your fourth place finish that was there. How much did this testing pay off and contribute to this victory today?
Paid off in dividends. I mean, this team, we knew we had something good at Sebring, but since then, with all the development work, it's unbelievable. The car is good. They've done a really good job.
Did he leave you a car at the end? Do you have any brakes left?
Not a lot of brakes, but I have to say hi to Sarah at home.
Congratulations to these guys. I don't think it'll be the last time you see him. You heard Alex Jobe say, these might be the only guys out there that have anything for us, and they did today, Ralph.
I think you're right, Brian. These guys are going to be around for a while, and here's a look at the GT standings.
He's got no traffic.
That's the top three in class. But van Overbeek and Law would have been the winners. And that actually would have been flip-flopped a little bit. Here's P1. We can show you that one. This one we know is straight. And we'll have J.J. Delato on top with Marco Werner, followed by the Dyson entry, Dayton and Field in third. Let's check in with Tracy Wolfson with another class winner.
I'm here with Johnny O'Connell and Ron Fellows of the number 3 Corvette car. Not only did you take first in class, you took third overall. The last time a GTS car did that in the ALMS, it was in 2000. What was the difference today?
Well, you know, you got to tip your hat first off to Pratt and Miller. They're so amazing as a team. Everyone with CompuWare, this is such an amazing effort. Of course, being on Michelin tires this year is critical to us. Motorola. There's so many people that are part of this effort, and my goodness, to finish third overall, we got a little bit lucky today. You know, I was disappointed yesterday. I didn't get the pole, but pole doesn't pay anything. I show up for Sundays, and just great job. Dan Binks on the radio is awesome, and then everyone just did a super job.
Ron, you guys had a tough time at Le Mans. You suffered a concussion. Does this make up for it?
It sure doesn't hurt, does it? No, this is great. Now, this is only a couple hours from Detroit, mid-Ohio, so to have all the people from GM Racing here, Mobile One, and Chevrolet, this is sweet to have a 1-2. So it, just like Le Mans, but it feels a little bit better for me today.
It's a lot better. Except I still had to do more laps, man. You still owe me. You still owe me.
Oh, you're like bickering teammates. It's so cute. Well, thanks a lot, guys. Back to you guys.
Thank you.
Johnny O'Connell was talking about that earlier as we take a look at the GTS finishing order. He said because Ron had that concussion at Le Mans, he had to do the extra stints with their other teammate, Max Pappas. He said from now on, Ron has to do all the extra duty.
Well, Sounds fair.
I think Ron still apparently has seniority. He got out of it a little bit. That GTS, the last time a GTS car was in third was in Adelaide, Australia, back in 2000. Let's head back downstairs.
Well, the winners in P2 were Clint Field and Robin Liddell. And Robin, your debut with the team, how's it feel good to see Victory Lane first time out?
Well, it's great. It's my first race in a prototype and first time in mid-Ohio, so it couldn't have been better. I'm absolutely thrilled.
Talk us through that. I mean, last year you were a keen competitor in the GT category. There's 4 classes in ALMS. That's one of the slower ones, obviously, so you're dealing with traffic coming from behind you as well. In the prototype cars, a little bit easier to deal with?
Well, it is because you've got a little bit more power on the straightaway, so you can obviously get by some of the slower cars. But, you know, in the twisty sections, the prototype's just great because it's got so much grip. So it's a real fun car to drive, and it means you can look in your own mirrors a little bit less and more at, the road ahead.
Great job. We're bringing Clint here. We're going to see more of this as your teammate for the rest of the season. What do you think?
I hope so. But, first of all, I got to thank Pirelli for putting it together because without them, we wouldn't have had him in the car. So it's good to have a guy like Robin, and he's a great guy, great driver. So I got to thank Pirelli, Marquee Financial, and Archangel.
What a month, huh?
Yeah, it's coming. To win Le Mans is great, and then to win at home is icing on the cake. So it's good.
congratulations to you both of you. Did a great job today. Let's go back to Ralph.
21 years old, Clint Field. You just won the biggest race in sports car racing, and then you win at your home track. Does it get any better, Bill?
Well, he's getting spoiled right now. But, you know, again, Mike Johnson, his crew chief, is going to say, it's all me. I did it again. You know, the kid had nothing to do. It's all my setup.
My guess is
he's doing a great
job. As you
job.
Look at the P2 standings, the finishing order from today, my guess is Clint will be on the phone to Pirelli first thing tomorrow morning, say, hey, we need this Liddell guy to stick around for a while.
Well, and I think even though Dad had less than a great day, he's got to be awfully happy for your son. I mean, geez, what a wonderful day to stand there and watch your son win Le Mans and then win the home race. A lot of pride.
Overall, a tremendous afternoon for that team. The number 30 winning in P2 today. Your perceptions of how the race went today, what did you think based on what we talked about at the beginning of the day?
You know, I'm really hugely disappointed for the Dyson Racing team just to suffer that frustrating loss of their number one car right at the drop of the green flag. It's a little bit crushing, and they had looked really forward towards this race after all of their testing, all of their development, things looked so promising, and it has to be a fluke. I'm sure they will approach it that way, but you heard it in JJ's voice, and they were saying they too were disappointed because to win a race in cruise mode, well, a win is always good, but in cruise mode is not nearly as satisfying.
Brian?
Well, third in GTS belongs to Terry Borcheller and Johnny Mollum. I know you stood by, probably the most interested spectator at the end, quite a battle, and a third for you guys here. A great job.
Yeah, we're real happy to have the podium, and a great job to Crone Barber Racing. I mean, coming out with a brand new car, they did a phenomenal job, and just hats off to them. And I'm real happy about Johnny's run at the end there. He did a good job, and the team really came together. We had a loose toe link when I got out, so Johnny had to come in right away, and they had to fix that pretty quickly. So pretty happy about the result, considering.
Well, it's great to see muscle cars like the Saleen and the Lamborghini out there.
Yeah, we just need to have a toe strap for those Corvettes. I don't know what we're going to do about that, but hello to my family. Love you guys. See you tonight.
Tonight on CBS begins with America's number one news magazine, 60 Minutes, followed by television's most watched new drama, Cold Case. And Melissa Gilbert and Ozzie Davis star in The Soul Collector. It's all here tonight on CBS, America's most watched network. Bill, the next time we'll see the series on CBS, Dale Earnhardt Jr. in a Corvette at Infineon. Should be great.
Boy, I am looking forward to that one because we have seen levels of talent here today, and Dale will fit right in here perfectly. He's looking forward to it.
And it'll be another couple of weeks of racing for the Lamborghini. That should be even better. Lots of great things. The Dyson team will really be looking forward to going to that track as well.
The Lamborghini will be back. We know it's going to be a faster car, but the action is just going to be nonstop when we get to this next one.
Possibly another Audi even by then.
I think you might see the Audi at that one, but I know for sure we are going to see the two Dyson cars, and they're going to be loaded for bear because they were very dominant there last year. So
it's been a tremendous afternoon of sports car racing with the American Le Mans Series here at Mid-Ohio. For Bill Adams, Tracy Wilson, Calvin Fish, and Brian Till, I'm Ralph Shaheen. So long from Mid-Ohio.